I always thought running was dumb.
So I never wanted to run, hated running.
I am not an athlete.
I'm not a runner.
I never thought I would run a marathon.
Why are we doing this? This is hard. It's because we're saving lives.
I was sitting in a spiritual recliner. You know, the lever on the side of that recliner, God just pulled it and ejected me out and said, get to work. I need to move.
The clean water crisis is something that we think of very little because nobody here in the U.S. has to walk 6 miles back and forth daily to get water. Because of World Vision's work, children are free to go to school. Women are able to go to work and build up their local community.
You know, I mean, I wouldn't describe myself as a super athlete. Can I go run 26 miles? I couldn't when training started, but today I can.
I've had 5 knee surgeries. This is a total gift that God's given back to me. I need to do something with it.
There are people who tell me all the time now that they are grateful that they can donate because they feel like they're running along with me.
The Team World Vision family, it is a family. It doesn't matter how fast or how slow we run. These are all people who are changing the world with their feet.
I'm not running for myself. I'm running for someone else's finish line. And that's what keeps me moving.
Friends, this weekend we're doing something that we've done for almost our whole history as Common Grace. We are kicking off our participation in Team World Vision. This is an opportunity for you to move your feet, to make a difference around the world, to make an impact in some of the most vulnerable people. This is an opportunity for you to proverbially or literally get off the couch and make a difference. And this is a challenge. But as somebody who is not a runner, who never considered himself a runner, and who has successfully completed a half marathon through this process, I can tell you that there's a lot of community to surround you along the way, and there's a lot of good that comes out of this. So if you want to know a little bit more about how you can be a part of this, or if you're even interested, this isn't a commitment, text Common Grace, one word, all caps, Common Grace, one word, to 44888. That information is in the description, so you can find it there. But I hope you'll consider being a part of Team World Vision this year as we move our feet for a great cause. Our reading today is just one verse. It's from John chapter 12, verse 24. Now, John's gospel doesn't really have any parables in it, the way that we think about parables, but we're going to share this, which I guess is a parable in a different form. Jesus in John's gospel speaks a little bit differently, but he does give this sort of metaphorical understanding that teaches us a truth about who we are and invites us to reflect on some important things in the midst of this Easter season. You know, we are in a season of Easter. Easter is not just about a single day, but it's a season that we go in which we're in invited to reflect on the significance and the power of resurrection in our lives. And so that's what we're going to do a little bit today. We're continuing our short stories with Jesus sermon series, looking at his parables. And so I wanted to include John's gospel in that. And so we're going to do that today. And again, I think it will be a good reflection for us. I would invite you to follow along. This is, again, just one verse. Hear these words. Jesus actually begins with, "Very truly I tell you," is how it's translated in the NRSV. But the text in the original Greek sounds something like this: "Amen, amen, lego humin." And throughout Jesus' speaking in John's gospel, he will say that often: "Amen, amen, lego humin." And it's essentially the writer's way of highlighting this and saying, this is very important. Listen to this. Pay attention to this. Sometimes when we read books, we begin to lull and pay a little less attention. And the author of John's gospel is saying, hey, listen. Jesus says, very truly, I tell you, that's how this begins. Very truly, I tell you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains just a single grain. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. May God add blessing to our reading and understanding of this text. So we're in the midst of this Easter season, and the funny thing about Easter is that we really want to talk about resurrection. We love the idea of resurrection. We love the promise of resurrection. We love the declaration by God that the worst word is never the last word, that life wins over death, that there is a love that wins, that there is something beyond what we can understand, that which seems total and final and seems like a complete train wreck, that even that can be redeemed. We love the idea of resurrection. We love the promise of it and the message of it. But there's this other thing about Easter that is also necessary for us to get to resurrection, and that's death. And oftentimes we want to just think about resurrection and we don't want to acknowledge that something has to die in order for something to be resurrected. Jesus had to have Good Friday for Easter Sunday to have any significance or meaning. It's not significant if Jesus is walking around and eating fish on the shoreline and talking to his disciples and speaking about who he is if he doesn't die on Friday. That's why all of that matters. You can't have the significance of resurrection of Easter Sunday unless you have the significance of Good Friday and of death. And sometimes in our lives, we want resurrection, but we don't want death. And it's understandable. But sometimes in our faith, we want to talk about resurrection without acknowledging the reality of death. We want to get to Sunday and skip over Friday. But friends, that's not how the world works. I believe that there are a million tiny resurrections that happen in our lives. That there are things within us that die and come back to life. That there are things around us that have to die in order that new life can come forth. One of my favorite artists is John Foreman, and he talks about a million little resurrections every time I fall. But there has to be a fall, there has to be a death, there has to be a loss, there has to be a change in order for us to experience the life that is promised. We see basic examples of this in nature and in our lives all around us. So we've already talked about launching Team World Vision, right? And you know, running may feel like death to you. Maybe that's the invitation. Is that the idea of running or walking? By the way, you can walk in Team World Vision. You can walk the Kansas City Half Marathon. We have people do it every year. It's a pretty incredible experience. But the idea of doing that may sound like you're just signing up for death. And if so, perhaps there's a promise of resurrection. But I mean, even the process of running sort of teaches us something about this, as does any sort of workout. What happens when we work out? We break down muscles. We tear them apart. Why do we do that? Because when they rebuild stronger. It's a little death that leads to some sort of resurrection. We see it when we take on too much responsibility. Perhaps we're compelled to do so because we want to please other people. We want other people to know that we're worthwhile, that we have value, that we can hold our own weight. We want them to be impressed with us. We want to keep them happy. We want to give of ourselves. And so we take on and we take on and we agree and we have more and more responsibilities and tasks and more things that we have to do. And what happens when we do enough of that is we take on so much that we can't do anything well. And we get burned out and we get exhausted and we get angry and we blow up and we make ourselves sick. And sometimes what needs to happen for us to move into a place of being healthy, sometimes what needs to happen for us to be able to do anything well is we have to let something go. Maybe that's a task. But maybe it's our need or our compulsion to please other people, to make them feel better, to take on too much so that somebody else feels okay or says that we're okay. But it's only when we let go of something, release some of that, that we can do what we're trying to do in the first place. Maybe it looks something like dying to our pride and our selfishness, our need for control. I don't know if you have any of those things, but I do. That sometimes I really want to be in charge. Sometimes I really want to know what comes next. And friends, the walk of faith doesn't always promise us those things. Sometimes I have to let go of my arrogance. sometimes I have to let go of what is, I feel like, my right to hold on to some bit of anger or resentment, to withhold some amount of forgiveness for somebody else. Sometimes there are things within us that have to die in order that we can experience life, in order that we can fully embrace the grace that God offers to you and I. Is there something within you that needs to be put to death, that needs to be let go, so that you may experience, as Jesus says elsewhere in John's Gospel, the life that is truly life? We're in an Easter season. We like talking about resurrection, but we have to talk about death as well so that we can get to the promise of resurrection. Sometimes, friends, it may come in things even more painful. The loss of a dream or hope or expectations that you had for your life. When plans blow up. The loss of options, when you thought you had all kinds of options and now there is just one, it can be excruciating. When we feel like the rug gets pulled out from under us, when all of our plans and expectations change, when everything that we've been working for suddenly becomes unattainable, when the people that we had always counted on being there no longer are there for us, when relationships end, when lives of loved ones end, it can all be awful, disorienting, disappointing. And yet the promise of Easter is that those words shall not be the last words. That even in the midst of all of that, there are resurrections happening all around us. The invitation and the question is whether we'll develop the lenses and the eyes to see it. Remember with me back a couple of weeks ago, we talked about pigsty moments. Do you remember that? We talked about the prodigal son on Easter who leaves his father and says, I want nothing to do with you except the money that you have for me. He doesn't hate his father. He just doesn't properly value his father. And so he wants something different. He takes what he has, he goes, and everything is great. He lives wild and fast and free, and it's just as he imagined until it isn't. Everybody loves him and parties with him until the money runs out. And then there's a famine in the land, and then he's out feeding the pigs. What I imagine is not a very fun job now, but probably would have had a lot of social implications in it for Jesus's original audience. And he longs to eat what the pigs have. And finally, the scripture says he comes to himself. Remember that your Bible may read that he came to his senses, but the Greek is that he came to himself. He remembered who he is. And he begins the trek home. We talked about sometimes when we hit rock bottom, that's when we come to ourselves. When the bottom falls out, that's when we come to ourselves. When we've made mistakes, that's when we come to ourselves. When what we've expected and hoped and dreamed and leaned on and what it is that we've built our life on and the expectations that we've had about our future, when those things get lost, sometimes we come to ourselves. That's an example. We talked about Peter's pigsty moment, three times denying Jesus just a few hours after he said, I will never deny or forsake you, Jesus. I'll stand by you no matter what happens. Until he doesn't. And the scripture says that he walked away and wept bitterly. That was his pigsty moment, I think, when he came to himself. And I think there has to be a realization in that moment that he's not as strong as he thought he was, and he can't do this by his own power and his own strength. He needs the grace of God at work in his life. And it is in the death of his self-reliance, in the realization that he can't do it all by himself, that he begins the possibility of resurrection. And so maybe resurrection looks like Jesus standing on the shoreline looking at Peter and saying, do you love me? Do you love me? Do you love me? Feed my sheep. Join in my work. Be a part of my life. Maybe resurrection looks like the Father staring off into the horizon, seeing a weird shape come down the road and realizing that it's his youngest son who has been lost and running out to meet him with arms wide open to say, welcome home. Perhaps that's what resurrection looks like in our lives. So I wonder, when has this happened in your life? When has it happened that something had to die in order that something else might live? When is it that you've had to deal with some sort of pervasive sin or some sort of difficulty or some sort of hang-up, some sort of pride or lust or greed or self-sufficiency? When has that had to die in you so that you could experience something better on the other side? When is it that you've had to let go of something? When is it that something's been taken from you and you thought that was the end of everything only to come to find out that there was something good and beautiful at the end? Maybe you had a relationship blow up and you thought that your whole life was over and then, well, then he walked into the room and now you can't imagine life without them. When has that happened in your experience? Or when has something good been lost? That's the reality, is that sometimes we lose a loved one and we find that we have space for new relationships. Sometimes we lose dreams and opportunities that aren't inherently bad. It's not as if they're leading us astray. We lose something good. And on the other side of it, we find something more good? Something better? Maybe just something different. When have those resurrections, small or large, happened in your life? You know, I was trying to think about how we evaluate these sorts of things. How do we make sense of them in the moment, and how do we make sense of them in retrospect when we look back? And I thought about a couple of things. So I've used a lot of language in this message about death and resurrection. And Jesus, in this little short parable that we shared, he uses language of death and growth, death and bearing much fruit. I think that's interesting because we are talking about resurrection. We are in this Easter season. But perhaps how we evaluate it in the moment or when we look back has something to do with talking about what has borne fruit. So when has something died so that something else could grow within you? When has something died so that more fruit may be born within you or around you in your world, in your life, in those you love? When have you seen good things grow and emerge on the heels of something else dying? When has letting go resulted in growth and grace for you? Maybe that's part of how we evaluate this. Jesus is talking about a truth of his ministry here on earth and a truth of what it means to be a follower of him, that in death, even in death, life is possible. That in death, even in death, all things are not over. That in death, yes, even in death, the final word will be life and grace. Another question that I thought about as I was thinking about how we evaluate the story and its truth in our own lives. Jesus talks about the seed falling to the ground. That is sort of a euphemism in first century Palestinian language for death. But it goes into the ground and it sort of disappears. And it got me thinking that if we really engage this story, if we'll visualize it, as we're often invited to, as we talk about these, parables, if we'll visualize that, that the seed of grain falls into the ground, that it's buried, it's gone, and it's no longer there, I wonder if we might ask ourselves, what does this incubation period look like? What happens in that moment? How long does that period last? How do we characterize that season? Are there parts of you, parts of your life that feel like you're in that incubation period and you're not sure yet if the tomb's going to be empty, if there's going to be life on the other side? You just know that something's died around you? Could it be that there's an art in the waiting and the anticipating what is yet to come? Could it be that you feel like some part of you or all of you has been in that incubation period, in that death, in that darkness for a very long time, and you're wondering whether there's going to be a resurrection? Could there be a promise that yes, life is going to happen, and it may not come on the timeline that we want, that we request, that we imagine for ourselves? Part of how we evaluate this in our lives, I think, has to do with how it is that we evaluate this incubation period, this waiting, this time in the ground, this experience of death. What do we call that? Do we call it dormancy? Do we call it death? Do we call it waiting? Do we call it hell? Do we call it anxiety or concern, grief, giving up, anticipation? What is it that we call that? I think how we characterize that probably gives us a lot to reflect on. We could probably gain a lot of perspective if we imagine what that season looks like. You might be able to point to your life and say, well, that season was hell, but this season felt just like a pause. So I want to share something. I was on that Tochi trip last week. I'm so grateful that Pastor Wes was able to fill in. But this is just a real life example of what I think this looks like. We were gathered with our team. Now, this team was a lot more diverse than I thought. We had people from like six different states, several who were either from here in the Kansas City area or related to Grace, and several who were either from Arizona or related to Dayspring United Methodist there. But there was people from Oregon and Colorado and South Carolina and Kansas and Arizona and probably some other places I'm forgetting. And all of us came together. By the way, this wasn't a huge team. This was like 20, 25 people. So we were all together. It was our second night, and we were trying to get to know one another. My role was a spiritual leader or something like that for the group. I can't remember what the title was, but I was supposed to lead some conversation with this group, all of us together. But it was not only all of us, but it was also folks from Mexico, and not just from where we were in Puebla, and not just from Mexico City, and not just from where we were going in Tochimilco, but people from all across Mexico. And so there is this diverse group of people. And I said, we're about to embark on this mission together. And I believe that God calls us to be a community of faith together as we serve with one another. And I just challenged them to imagine what it was that they were carrying with them into that time that we were going to share together. What was it that was drawing their minds back to home, wherever that was? Was it work responsibilities? Was it family responsibilities? Was it a fight you had with your spouse? Was it a good thing, like your children, like a new opportunity that was coming? What was it that was pulling you out of the community that God had gathered there together in that place? And what I challenged them is I said, if you can, I just wonder, what would it look like to let go of that and trust that to God? Or maybe you can't let go of it. Maybe caring for a family member and worrying about a family member is just something that you're not ready to let go of. What would it look like to give just a little bit of that to God? You don't have to let go of everything. What is it that you could leave behind? And here's the deal, friends. The reason that I said that was so that we might be present with one another and to the work that God is doing here, into the relationships that we'll build in Tochimilco, into the service that we'll do in our medical and dental mission. What is it that we might unencumber ourselves of so that we might experience the joy and the fullness and the life of that moment? What is it that we need to let go of to allow to die or to put on the shelf so that we may experience fruit and much growth, as the parable says? We had some big things happening in our family's life back home. So I'm saying all of this and I'm thinking to myself, Pastor, are you going to let that go? And truthfully, the answer was that I couldn't. There was deadlines that needed to be met and things that needed to be signed and lots of change happening. And so I was doing all of that. And finally, about halfway through the trip, we moved to the end of all of those things, to everything that was on a deadline, to everything that I had to be a part of, to the decisions that had to be made. And y'all, it was so interesting. Because moving from the night that it all finished into the next day, I felt so much more free. To have let that go and to be allowed to be present in that community, it changed so much. And the level of relationship that I was able to build with people in our group and with people in Tochi and with people from the other states and areas, it just went up exponentially. And the amount of joy and laughter and freedom and levity that I experienced in that was completely different. And I think the same invitation is there for you and I each and every day. There are things that we can let go of. There are things that we need to let go of. There are things that we need to let die. But the promise is that death will not be the final word, that there is resurrection and life. The promise of the parable is that unless something falls into that dormancy, into that waiting, into that darkness, and yes, perhaps even into that death, it cannot grow and multiply and produce much fruit. What is it that needs to be let go in your life? So that God may bring forth beautiful fruit in life in new and amazing and unexpected ways. Let's take a few moments for reflection.